There we go.
56 to 60.
That's all mute. Let's proceed with our land acknowledgement. While muted, reading together. We, the people of Isiland United Church of Foster City, acknowledge that we are on the unceded ancestral homeland of the Ramaytush Ohlone, who are the original inhabitants of the San Francisco Peninsula. As the indigenous stewards of this land, and in accordance with their traditions, the Ramaytush Ohlone have never ceded, lost, nor forgotten their responsibilities as the caretakers of this place, as well as for peoples who reside in their traditional territory. As guests, we recognize that we benefit from living and working on their traditional homeland. We wish to pay our respects by acknowledging the ancestors, elders, and relatives of the Ramaytush community, and by affirming their sovereign rights as First Peoples. Good morning. My name is Jim Mitulski, and I want to welcome you to Isiland United Church on this 13th Sunday of Pentecost, and also the day on which we observe each year the life, celebrate the life, and acknowledge the death, the violent death of Emmett Till. So much of the readings and the songs and other materials this week relate to our Emmett Till commemoration. We remember him as we would a martyr in the church. I'm sorry, I'm trying to read something from Vicki right now. Okay. Emmett Till was a 14-year-old young man, from Chicago, who was murdered in 1955 in Money, Mississippi, while on a visit there. And the story is perhaps familiar to you. Both Vicki and I were in a workshop yesterday sponsored by the United Church of Christ Northern California Conference, to which we belong, in which Ruby Sales, a civil rights activist, among other things, or a person who was active in the movement for Southern movement for Black freedom, as she called it, described the importance for us of being familiar with the history of what took place throughout our country's history in order for us to be able to acknowledge and change. So that's one reason why we do this in church as a solemn commemoration each year. We'll hear a song about Emmett Till that tells the story. We'll hear an interview with his mother. Reverend Mark Wilson is going to sing a special song that I commissioned from him for us at the end of the service. So it's a more solemn service than usual, but I ask you to enter into the spirit of remembrance, solidarity, and commitment in our ongoing process of being a church that is anti-racist. So I won't say anything more about it. Let's just experience it. And we'll proceed with the call to worship. And I'm going to ask us first to say these words that Emmett Till's mother, Mamie Till Mobley, was heard to speak out at a gathering after her son's death. And it was recorded in the Chicago Defender, the Black newspaper of record at the time, and still an important newspaper. So let's read her words while muted. Lord, you gave your only son to remedy a condition, but who knows but what the death of my only son might bring an end to lynching. Lord, take my soul, show me what you want me to do, and make me able to do it. And then I'll read this poem as our opening words by the Pulitzer-winning poet Gwendolyn Brooks. The last quatrain of the Ballad of Emmett Till. After the murder, after the burial. Emmett's mother is a pretty-faced thing. The lint of puffed taffy, the tint of puffed taffy. She sits in a red room, drinking black coffee. She kisses her killed boy, and she is sorry. Chaos in windy grays through a red prairie. And let's one more time say her words like a prayer. Lord, you gave your only son to remedy a condition, but who knows what the death of my only son might bring an end to lynching. Lord, take my soul, show me what you want me to do, and make me able to do it. And let's pray this prayer from the Book of Common Prayer. This is a prayer for a martyr. Almighty God, by whose grace and power your holy martyr, Emmett Lewis Till, triumphed over suffering and was faithful even to death, grant us who now remember him in thanksgiving to be so faithful in our witness to you in this world that we may receive with him the crown of life through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. And let's sing while muted for all the saints. Thank you.
I too give honor to God, who is the source of my strength and the reason for my being. In 1955, when my only child was killed, it seemed that there was nothing for me to live for. I wanted to die. But in the midst of that planning, the Lord spoke to me, and he told me not to spend my time hating the perpetrators of the crime, because they would not even know that I was hating them. And the things that would be released into my body would eventually destroy me. And while I was pondering that statement, something was spoken to me, and that something was, I am the ruler of heaven and earth. I see all things. I'm commissioning you to go into the vineyard and work. And what is right, I will pay. And don't forget that vengeance is mine. And a wonderful thing happened to me. It seemed like someone took a giant eraser, and my mind had become a chalkboard, and everything, all memories of Mr. Milam and Mr. Bryant were erased from my thoughts. I was able to go out into the vineyard and work, which I'd been commissioned to do, and that work turned out to be training boys and girls to do Dr. King's speeches. I can truthfully say that for 47 years, I have not wasted any time hating Milam and Bryant. They became inconsequential so far as I was concerned. It was as if they didn't even exist. And since I have had time to think things over, I don't want anyone dead. And even the people that are proven guilty, and these two men did confess of their foul deed, but even so, I do not wish, I don't have the balance of life and death in my hands that was entrusted to God himself. He sends us here, he takes us away. I do know that from time to time, I've heard rumors of Milam and Bryant. I know that both of them lost two sons each because they were married to two women, and those two women, their little sons were about the same age, four down. And they did not have the pleasure of spending their lives with their sons. And I do know that they thought they were heroes, but when their backers backed up and would not support them, they spent a very miserable life wondering, we are the heroes, and all of a sudden we are nobody. So I'm sure that they paid. They're both deceased now, but I am sure that they paid for their error. But another thing I know, they never confessed repentance. They never regretted what they had done. In fact, in a three-way conversation with Bryant, he said he would do the same thing over again, and not only to Emmett Till, but to whoever got in his way. So I think, I felt sorry for him that he did not have a spiritual life, and I just wonder where he thought he was going to spend eternity, or if he thought he was going to be here forever. Because there's one sentence that you cannot escape, and that is when you go before the judgment seat of God, he will give the verdict. And I am glad that he took hatred out of my heart and had me to go on with my life, speaking whenever someone called on me to speak. And then I went to school, became a teacher, And I, believe me, when you're dealing with children all day, you have so many problems, or they have so many problems, that you are trying to help them resolve until it doesn't leave time for self-pity or dwelling in the past. You've got to be in the future and jumping ahead as fast as you can to help those that you're trying to take along to higher heights and deeper depths in knowledge and in the fear of God. Thank you.
So long ago, when a young boy from Chicago town walked through his southern door, this most fateful tragedy you should all remember well. The color of his skin was black, and his name was Emmett. Some men, they dragged him to a barn, and there they beat him up. They said they had a reason, but I just remember what. They tortured him and did some things too evil to repeat. There were screaming sounds inside the barn, laughing sounds out on the street. Then they rolled his body down a gulf amidst a blood red rain, and they threw him in the waters wide to cease his screaming pain. The reason that they killed him there, and I'm sure it ain't no for the fun of killing him and to slowly watch him die. And then to stop the United States of yelling for a trial, two brothers, they confessed that they had killed poor Emmett too. But on the jury there were men who helped the brothers commit this awful crime. And so this trial was a mockery, but nobody seemed to mind. I saw the morning papers, but I could not bear to see the smiling brothers walking down the courthouse stairs. For the jury found them innocent, and the brothers, they went free. While Emmett's body floats the foam of a Jim Crow southern sea. If you can't speak out against this kind of thing, the crime that's so unjust, your eyes are filled with dead man's dirt, and your mind is filled with dust. Your arms and legs, they must be in shackles and chains, and your blood, it must refuse to flow for you to let this human race fall down so god-awful. This song is just a reminder to remind your fellow man that this kind of thing still lives today in that ghost robe of Ku Klux Klan. But if all us folks that thinks alike, if we'd give all we could give, we'd make this great land of ours a greater place to live.
So before the video begins, we're going to ask Diane to say something about it, because she was present at the event last week where Mercy Moya spoke. And she was an organizer of the event, I should say. So you have to unmute, Diane.
Yeah, I thank you for the opportunity to introduce Mercy. Our event, and of course, coming after the powerful song and the presentation of Mamie Till, and being struck by her faith, and that we're in a people joined together by faith, and our work on anti-racism isn't just because it's right, it's because also we are people of faith. Our event, and which Alexis Lewis really was instrumental in providing or finding, locating, and asking the speakers, which were just the perfect speakers for that day, a variety of wonderful speakers. We had originally asked Dr. Penny Nixon, and then it emerged that Mercy was available to speak to us. And I was looking back at the goal of our March for Racial Justice and the work that we've done with John Lewis. And we wrote it down as an intergenerational and multi-faith event, which participants are encouraged to identify, participate, and engage in activities that address racism and inequality locally, nationally, and particularly in collaboration with each other. So we had a group of people together at the park listening to Mercy and the other speakers. And my feeling after I listened to her and the other speakers, but particularly Mercy, is we can still say we know racism is alive and well in San Mateo, and our job is to do what our friend John Lewis told us. When you see something that is not right, not fair, not just, you have to speak up. You have to say something. You have to do something. And the message we received after Mercy's talk is, if we see something, if we see Mercy or some other person, the most effective thing we can do is go stand by them and be there and stand up with them. But thank you for letting me introduce her talk. It's much more profound than my words. And so with that, let's listen to Mercy.
I was lucky enough to grow up in the bubble. In this bubble is in a beautiful environment I grew up in. I thought I had the same rights as my parents, who are white, and my aunties, who are also white. I didn't know people like me were criminals just because of the color of our skin. I can't breathe. I can't breathe, said Eric Garner as he was being choked to death by the white police officers who are supposed to protect all citizens. But is protect the right word to use these days? The police officers are supposed to keep us safe. Is safe the right word? Am I safe as a black person? I just want to walk down the street without looking over my shoulder every 10 minutes. And even if my parents are with me, I still look. I was born in Zimbabwe. No, with no fear. Now I live here. I fear walking down the street, going into a store, and even going to the mall with my friends. Even though I live in the bubble, I still have gotten the message that the color of my skin makes most white people feel endangered. One day, as I was spending time with my chosen sister, and we were both in a store. I was near the door. The manager thought I was stealing stuff just because my hands were in my pocket. She asked to see my hands, so I showed her my empty hands. And she still thought I stole something. She walked away, but never let me go out of her sight. By the way, I was the only black person in the store. I was 13 years old, looking for something special to buy for my parents. My sister, who is white, watched me be accused of stealing, even though she knew I would never steal anything. I got home, told my parents. I went back to the store with my mom and tried to confront the manager, but she wasn't there. Clearly, the color of my skin made me a suspicious, dangerous, a criminal. Why are my people always on the ground? Why are my people always bleeding from gunshots? Why are my people always dying almost every day? We need to find a different solution to these situations.
Hey, Bob.
Go ahead. Please. Okay. Yeah.
Okay. The Bible reading today is John 6, verses 56 through 69. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because the Father, so he who eats me will live because of me. This is the bread which came down from heaven, not such as the fathers ate and died. He who eats this bread will live forever. This he said in the synagogue as he taught at Capernaum.
So today I'm going to talk a little bit, I'm going to talk about the Bible passage, but also about Emmett Till. It's a story I've told every year that I've been with you, and a story that no doubt many of you are familiar with. But it's important to tell it every year, and especially to tell it every year in church, just like we tell the stories of the important martyrs from our history. Martyr, remember, is a word that just means witness, and other exemplars of faith, and people who are important to us, even when they're not important necessarily to other people in the outside world. I wish that more churches would observe Emmett Till. Many Black churches will be observing this either this Sunday or next Sunday, because the anniversary of his death is this week, somewhere, probably Friday, I think it is. So there's a choice about whether to do it this week or next week. I wish that more churches in our United Church of Christ tradition did, and maybe someday they will. But it's important that we do it, because we have been on a journey the last few years of reading anti-racism books, of participating in anti-racism activities, learning about our own history as a church and as a country. And Emmett Till's story is one that is essential to understand and keep before us, not only for what happened in that moment in 1955, but because it's a story that had an impact in the immediate years afterwards, and also because it's still what happened to Emmett Till still happens today. So John Lewis, who I've been talking about a lot this summer, I know, and I thought I was done with him last Sunday or completed the series, did say, talk about in his last statement, the piece that was printed in the New York Times, how Emmett Till was his George Floyd. And at the time that Trayvon Martin was killed, John Lewis received some criticism for comparing Emmett Till to Trayvon Martin. Remember the young man in Florida. So it's a story that is not an unusual story. It's not the first story of a Black teenager being murdered and the justice system overlooking it on purpose, but it was the first one that came to prominent national attention in the way that it did in 1955. In a way that came to prominent national attention for both Black and white America. And that's an important reason for us to commemorate it too. Emmett was born in 1941 in Chicago, and his mother was from Mississippi. She raised him mostly as a single mother. And this is one thing I have learned that it's important to say. When we talk about Emmett Till, it's so easy to think about him and his death. But I did some digging this week, and I wanted to be sure that I could tell you of just a few things about him before his death, because he was more than a young man who was murdered. He was a teenager with a long, promising life before him. He would have turned 80 this year if he had lived. That would have been his 80th birthday last month. And we have to remember that he's more than just a picture or a story, though he has enormous symbolic meaning. You know, if we know the stories of the martyrs from the New Testament, from 2,000 years ago, we surely should know the story of what happened to Emmett Till. So I found an interview with his cousin, Ollie Gordon, and she was just a child when he was killed, 7 years old, but they lived together. Their parents shared an apartment in Chicago. So she knew Emmett. They lived together as children in the same apartment. And here are some things from this interview that I just want to remind us about to make him more dimensional to us. She said, first of all, though, I understand it when someone is called the new Emmett Till. They don't know what else to compare it to. A lynching can still be a lynching without the hanging. And that was what she said just last month. But she talked about what was he like as a kid. And this is what she said. He was a jokester. He loved to make people laugh. There was a time when he took $2 bills and in between them, he cut up newspaper pages to the same size with a dollar on the top and one on the bottom. He looked like he had a big wad of money. He showed it to his mom. She asked, where did you get all this money from? He was lying down on the floor laughing. I remember riding around the neighborhood with his mom looking for him when he was out past his curfew. His mom was single at the time, so he had chores and responsibilities. He was very capable of paying the bills, the gas bill, the light bill, and cleaning up the house. He had a stutter because he had polio when he was younger, and it left him with a speech impediment. He did okay in school, but he wasn't a lover of school. He did enough to get by because his mom was on him. He had a golden retriever named Mike, and he was very fond of the dog. So he would go over to the A&P, she said, and he would help customers take their groceries home to earn spending money. His grandmother made sure that he was very respectful to the older people. He would shovel the snow and rake the leaves for the neighbors. He was the only child, and his mother doted on him. He was spoiled, but he was loved and disciplined. They had rules and expectations of him as a young man. I remember our last Christmas together in December 54. He'd gotten that big, but you see him wearing that big hat that you see him wearing in all his pictures. He was leaning on the TV, and myself and my siblings are sitting on the sofa. So I just wanted to put those images in your mind because he was more than the young boy who was killed. These are not, you know, extraordinary stories, but I know you have children in your life. So these stories will remind you that he could be your child. And that's what John Lewis said. He could have been me. That's what he remembered thinking in 1955. Oh my God, that could be me. They're the same age. And he said, that's what young Black children his age thought all the time. That could have been me. His cousin, a different cousin, Simeon Wright, witnessed his abduction. Oh, so here's what happened, right? He goes to, I know you know the story, but I'll just remind us. He goes to spend the summer in Mississippi. He'd been begging his mother for a motorized bicycle, by the way. And she said, no, it was too dangerous. And finally and he'd also been wanting to go to visit relatives in Mississippi. And she remembers saying this, and I read it a couple of times in interviews. Oh my God, it'd be safer for him to go to Mississippi than it would be for him to get this motorized bicycle. So she took him to the train station just before going. She gave him a ring that had belonged to his father, a signet ring, you know, with his initials. And he was very proud of it. It was too big for him, so they used scotch tape and string to make sure that the ring would stay on his finger. This becomes important later. Off he went, and that was the last she saw of him. Just a few days later, he and his cousins were in a store in Money, Mississippi. Already that summer, two different Black men had been killed for voting or registering to vote in that town. Shot in plain sight, and their killers were found not guilty by all white juries. This was the summer after Brown versus Education, Board of Education, the desegregation trial. So many people think this was what was motivating a lot of this, the anger about the orders to desegregate schools. So Reverend George Lee, he was an NAACP member in Belmont, and he was the one who was shot and killed at point blank range after trying to vote. And then Lamar Smith, another Black man, is killed in front of the county courthouse before witnesses after voting, after casting his ballot. That was just 2 months before, in 1955. So this town was already not a great place. But while in the store, he and his cousins, 14 at the time year old Emmett, well, here's how it's originally told. Flirted with 21-year-old Carolyn Bryant, a married white woman, and touched her and joked with her. And then when he left the store, he whistled, a so-called wolf whistle. This is important detail. In retaliation for this, he was a few days later taken from his home by Carolyn's husband and a relative, beaten, killed, and his body put in the river, Tallahatchie River. Sorry. Now, just a few years ago, Carolyn Bryant recanted her story and said, actually, none of that happened. The whistle happened. He did whistle. And his cousin said, oh my God, why did you do that? You're going to get killed. And that was an exaggeration. He never flirted with her. He never touched her in the ways that she said. She made it up. What he did do was, in making change, he touched her. He was supposed to, as was the custom in their town, put the money on the counter and take the money from the counter. But in Chicago, that wasn't expected. So he did break a taboo, but he did not do these sexually related things. And part of, you'll hear Mark Wilson reference this, part of what, why Emmett was killed was because he was a threat as a young Black man to white male sexuality, white male pride, her husband's. So she made it up. I mean, I don't even know what to say about that. There were no consequences for her. It was way past the statute of limitations for the lies that she told in court. But to take it back to the story, they found his body in the river. They informed his mother. They had to smuggle his body out of Mississippi to get it up to Chicago because they didn't want, the authorities didn't, in Mississippi, didn't want them to have the body. And one of the ways they identified him, remember this is before DNA testing, was that he was wearing that ring, that signet ring that his mother had just given him with his father's initials. He was otherwise almost unrecognizable. His mother insisted on an open casket funeral. And it was photographed because she said she wanted the world to see what the world had done, what had been done to her son. This is the thing that changed the conversation nationally and internationally, both Black and white people, because Jet Magazine, a Black magazine, published the photographs, and then the Chicago Defender, a newspaper, published it, and then other newspapers picked it up. They had not seen such brutality in a widespread way. And it motivated people. They weren't going to even have a trial, but they were forced to have a trial. At the trial, of course, the fact that these photographs originated in a Black publication was used against the prosecution because they said that they couldn't be trusted. And they said that they never properly identified his body. So how could his accused killers be found guilty? His killers, by the way, Roy Bryant and his brother, J.W. Milan, whom Amy Till Mobley mentions, confessed right away, proudly. They told the story all over town. They told it for the press. It was in Look magazine. They weren't ashamed, but they knew they would never be convicted. The trial. They found Emmett's uncle, Moses Wright, a minister, whom they referred to in court continually as Uncle Moses, not Mr. Wright, stood up in court and identified the two white men as those who had abducted Emmett. It's a very brave act. He was a witness. He saw something and he risked his life. And they had to take him out of town afterwards immediately in order to save his life, to preserve it. And his cousin, Simeon Wright, who was his age, talked about that in another interview that I don't have time to quote from now. But he did tell the truth. Mamie Till Mobley went from Chicago to testify that it was her son. And the defense argued that they couldn't identify him They didn't prove it. They accused the NAACP of planting the body in the river as a way to garner sympathy for the what they called the civil rights movement at the time. And the defendants sat there smiling, laughing, and continued to say they had done it. The defense attorney told the jury that they could not convict them because it would be convicting their whole way of life and essentially convicting white supremacy. And the exact quote I want to share with you is this. Well, I could do it from memory. Every last Anglo-Saxon person on this jury, he said, has an obligation to find them not guilty. And that's what happened. They commented about Mamie Till Mobley's poise. The white newspapers couldn't get over her good English and proper diction and her poise, her dignity. They would not use her married name or call her Mrs. Mobley. They called her Mamie as an act of dismissal. But she was resolute in her desire to make a lifelong witness on behalf of her son. And you saw what she said in the video. So I could, as you know, I could go on and on about this and I won't. But I urge you to find out about his story. It's a beautiful story and it impacted people. Rosa Parks, 4 months later, said when she was on the bus and asked to move back, she almost did move back in Montgomery, but she remembered Emmett Till and an image of him came into her mind. And that's what caused her to refuse to give up her seat. There are many other subsequent civil rights leaders, as we call them, who have cited the example of how the memory of him motivated them to do something. Now, there has been, and there currently sits before Congress, something called the Emmett Till Anti-Lynching Act. It was killed most recently by Senator Rand Paul because he said, well, it's a little extreme. Someone could be overcharged just by beating someone up. They could get a hate crime penalty. I mean, the logic is too much to even think about. But there have been many attempts to pass an anti-lynching bill, over 200 attempts in Congress, and none of them have passed. And this current one is languishing there because of the way bills are passed and not passed. And it was Senator Rand Paul who says it, who said, this is just too extreme. Lynchings can still be lynchings even without a hanging. That's what his cousin said just this past summer, his surviving cousin. And I urge us to think about that because that bill should pass. Jesus in the gospel this morning, Lee read the part about being the bread of life and how we live eternally if we eat this bread and the bread from heaven. And then there's a little part that comes afterwards in which the disciples said, you know, this is too hard, what you're asking of us. This is a hard saying. Who can listen to it? They said, because he was asking them to take a stand in public. If you see something, say something. That's what John Lewis said. Do you take offense at this? Jesus said in John 6, 62, 61 and 62. And he said, I know some of you don't believe this. I know that. I know some of you find it too hard. But I need you to believe, he said. that if you participate in this work, that I will be in you, I'll be with you, and we will survive to eternal life. Emmett Till lives every time someone intervenes or stands in solidarity with the death of a young person who is being harassed by police or by anyone on account of their race. That's how we embody what Jesus is saying. It's a hard saying to hear, but when we don't, we become part of the problem. Do you wish to go away? Jesus said to them, because he could tell these words were hard. And Simon Peter, who was not a perfect person, who, as we know, failed Jesus time and time again, because we don't always live up to everything, still said to him, I am not giving up on this ideal, because who else would we go to? You have the words of eternal life. And Jesus still speaks those words to us. Are these hard sayings? Are these hard stories to hear? Yes, they are. They challenge us. But I'll tell you, when I heard Mercy speaking last Sunday in Central Park in San Mateo, how she felt unsafe as a teenager in San Mateo and didn't necessarily feel that the police were there to protect her, I knew she was speaking truth. And I thought, oh no, this can't be. We can't let this go on. We have to do something now. Our Christian commitment causes us to care and notice. The failure to pass the Anti-Lynching Act causes us to care. So I have two things I want to ask you to do as we remember Emmett Till today. One, pray for the children of our congregation, all of the children. That means the adult children too. That means like when Ed talked about his son last week, or when Lee talks about her adult children, pray for them. Even though they're adults still, pray for them. Anyone can do that, okay? And then I think about, in particular, some of the children or near children who are still children, who especially need, you know, Helen, when you talk about Raja, Alexis, when you talk about Kennedy, when I see Sophie, and I think about Paul's adult children, Paul and Sherry's, who are Jewish. What do you think about our youngest member baptized 2 weeks ago, Sydney? I don't want them to end up like Emmett Till. And I know you don't too. Pray for them. Pray for them every day. And honest children too, and others I may not be saying. The other thing I ask you to do, it's what Diane said these words earlier this week, and I've been mulling them over in my head over and over again. If you see something, because they were John Lewis's words, but it's a campaign she wants the multi-faith coalition to adopt. If you see something, say something. And another speaker from the NAACP last Sunday, Morris Goodman, said to us, if you see something, be something. Don't just say something, do something, you know, as part of our faith. If we see racism unfolding, let's do something. Let's speak up, let's do something. That's how we remember Emmett Till in 2021. Amen.
Thank you.
So I'm going to ask you to unmute yourselves. I'm switching to gallery and invite to prayers. So what are your prayers this morning? What prayers do you have? Lee.
Continued prayers for Eddie, Nadia, and Erica.
Peg?
Prayers for Thanksgiving. They were able to remove Dick's very large kidney stone.
Great. Other prayers, Diane?
Both prayers for Thanksgiving, because there are, in this time that's so troubling, it's so hard to even think about, you know, how we can find any joy because so many sad things are going on in the world. There are things that I'm very thankful for with my family. My children, my adult children, and my grandchildren are doing well. I have a particular niece, though, I'd like prayers for. She's going through some problems that are we're trying to identify, but give her some prayers. So both petition and Thanksgiving. Thank you.
Alexis?
Thank you, Reverend Jim. First, I would like to ask for prayers for the people of Haiti and Afghanistan and the terrible situation that they're in. Also, prayers for my friend Phyllis. Her dad, Mr. Anderson, is being moved to hospice, and the family is just very devastated. So prayers of comfort to them. Also, prayers for my friend Karn. Her brother, Eric John Holton, is having surgery tomorrow on his liver. And Karn said, I want you to say Eric's full name, just so that God doesn't get him mixed up with some other Eric. So Eric John Holton, we are praying for you. I'd also like to ask for prayers for the living members of Emmett Till's family. It must be difficult for them when his the anniversary of his death comes around. I can't imagine how they must feel even after all of these years, just to know that a child was beat by adult men and barbed wire wrapped around him and a fan, a motor from a fan connected to his body, and then he was shot and thrown into a river. Those details must, they're gut-wrenching to me and upsetting to me. So I can't imagine what it must be for them, and not even his family, but I'm sure he still has some classmates and neighborhood friends that are still alive that you know, deal with this anniversary. And then I'd just like to end on a more happier note. My daughter Tina Marie and granddaughter Kennedy are in Chicago to visit family on her way back to New York for school. And so they were able to take a tour and go by Barack Obama's house and see the plaque from Barack and Michelle's first date and first kiss. So they're having a good time. And I have a cousin who's a nurse in Chicago. By day, and by night she's a comedian, so she has a show at the Laugh Factory tonight, so the girls will be able to go and see her comedy skit. Thank you.
Others? Helen.
Continued prayers for my niece Chris and sister Mimi, who continues to hold on to life and try to hold, to be strong, all the family. Prayers, as always, for my family and for students who are facing many challenges, whether they're in beginning kindergarten or fifth grade or middle school, wherever they are. I know Kennedy has her own challenges, as Raja does in seventh grade. So student and teachers, this is a very difficult time for teachers of all kids and parents.
Okay, if I'm missing anyone, I apologize. I think I am, hope not. Let's pray. God, we begin our prayers this morning for the people of Haiti as they continue to suffer now with a death toll, a multi-thousand death toll, the effects of the earthquake and bad weather and poverty and political instability. We pray that our prayers and also our gifts financially will make a difference for them. We pray for the people of Afghanistan, for our military personnel on the ground, who are helping people to evacuate safely, hopefully, for their safety. Pray for the women and children of Afghanistan, for that troubled region, for our country's role in it. We just offer it up in prayer today, God. We have a number of people that we are concerned about, that we pray for healing or comfort in mind, body, or spirit. For Eddie, Nadia, Erica, Dick, Diane's niece, for Chris and Mimi, for Phyllis and for Mr. Anderson, for Karn and for Eric John Holton, make no mistake. For Reverend Gwen Fuqua's father, Norman, who asked us to pray for him this morning, so we're praying for him. Others who are on our minds or hearts, we don't, it's good to name them. And we don't have to name them. We could just think their names and we know their prayer and healing energy. So in the name of Jesus, the healer, we pray for them. We pray for those who have died recently or in the past. Pray for Emmett Till, for his mother, Mimi Till Mobley, and for his surviving family members and friends. Others who are on our mind. We'll be in Michigan this week, and my sister and I are going to go see our parents' grave in Brighton together, which we haven't had a chance to do. For all the people that we've lost, we take solace in the knowledge of resurrection to eternal life. We pray for our country, for our world, for our church, for the Congregational Church of Belmont, for unspoken petitions, and for many thanksgivings. We add this prayer to you in your many names. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. If you have your bread and cup for communion, I invite you to bring them and remember the words of Jesus. My flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. This is the bread which came down from heaven. Whoever partakes of me will live because of me. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. In today's gospel. So we take this bread in memory of Jesus, and this drink in memory of Jesus. This bread which we eat is a participation in Christ's body. This cup which we drink is a participation in his life. Please remember the church in your financial gifts and giving. Please give generously. Also, we put in the bulletin this week, in the e-weekly, a way to give to support the United Church of Christ's relief efforts in Haiti. So I'm going to go out on a limb and say this. I believe the board will approve a $250 matching gift, which is what we normally do, to the UCC for Haiti relief. And I'm going to ask congregants if we could help match that so that our total gift from Island United Church is $500 toward their $100,000 goal. So you can do that by sending a check and just put Haiti in a memo, or you can follow the directions in the newsletter, or you can make a direct gift. They tell you how you can identify Island Church, but it doesn't even matter, because in the long run, what we want to do is support the people of Haiti. So please give generously. And I haven't found a way yet to give to Afghan relief. I'm working on it. It's more complicated, frankly. but I am working on it. Diane knows this too, because we've been trying to find a way for the Peninsula Multi-Faith to give. If you have a way that you give, I mean, Doctors Without Borders, things like that, those are always good. They're not religious groups, but that's okay. But I'll let you know this week. Announcements. I'm going to be gone Monday through Thursday. The reading group, we've already talked about this, will not meet on Thursday. I'll be in Michigan. Two of those days I'm flying, basically, because you can't get there from here anymore easily. Reverend Michael Cronin is going to be covering the prayer meeting on Thursday night. So we'll have prayer meeting Thursday night. I'm supposed to be back, but I don't trust the flights. So he's going to cover. And next Sunday, we are worshiping at Congregational Church of Belmont. So I confirmed all this morning with their board president. What does that mean? They have church at 10:30. So you can go there, and they have a big, I haven't been in it, but I've seen pictures, and there'll be a picture in the bulletin, but they have a big high ceiling sanctuary with plenty of doors and windows. They are requiring everyone to be masked, and they've been doing this all summer. So obviously only do what you feel comfortable doing, but they want to invite us, and I'm preaching. They are serving lunch afterwards, a soup lunch. If you come early, if you come at 9 o'clock, they're making sandwiches for the night ministry in San Francisco. So it's a service project. If you feel like you want to do that and get to know people, they encourage us to come. This will all be in the newsletter this week. Also, you can watch their worship service on Facebook Live. I'm going to put the link in the newsletter this week. As soon as our church service is over, but before the board meeting, I'm going to try it. to make sure it works. So, but they say you don't have to be a member of Facebook to do it. So I haven't tried it. I don't know, but they swear by it. So I apologize in advance if that doesn't work. But everyone's doing their best. Please come. They want to meet us. They want to talk to us. It could be the only thing we ever do together, but they're a church of our size, also in pastoral search. There's five little churches in San Mateo County in various stages. We're going to be looking for a minister this fall. They're looking for a permanent minister. College Heights Church is looking. Some of the other churches are in various stages of transition. So none of this has to do with the big church. This is the five little churches. So we're just trying to see what makes sense right now. So come, right? Alexis has a cool announcement for us.
Thank you, Reverend Dem. We're having a council meeting at 12 today, so everybody's welcome if you'd like to come. And we have a new secretary that's going to join us today and join the council. Vicki Robinson has agreed to be our new church council secretary. So I'm really happy. Welcome, Vicki. I'm excited about you being on the council and look forward to working with you. So welcome.
Yay. I don't have any other announcements. So Nancy has put together a very cool special sections of the newsletter this month on the flora and fauna of Foster City. If you haven't sent, that means your plants and animals, either stuff you see or plants or animals you live with. Send them in, send more pictures in to Nancy. We'll continue the series, right? Let's watch our closing video. This is from Reverend Mark Wilson, who has done stuff for us before. I asked him to do something for us today that is specifically about Emmett Till.
Hello again, Island Community Church. It's good to be in your worship service one more time. Pastor Jim informed me that you are celebrating your recognition of Emmett Till, the young man that who was murdered in 1955 for apparently, wasn't sure, not making passes and whistling at a white woman, and he was killed by her husband and her brother-in-law. What do I recall about Emmett Till? 1955, I wasn't born. I was born years later, 1960, but I remember several things that the impact of Emmett Till's death had upon my family and household. One thing, I noticed that our family, my mother was always nervous about us going swimming with white kids growing up here in Oakland. We were in a white neighborhood, and there were the pools that accepted us. There were some pools that told us that African-American kids, we could not swim with the white kids in California. But not only there, at Howard University, there were football players who were scared to be in the water. And it often went back to the fact that his body, Emmett Till's body, was found in the Tallahatchie River. And the fear was that we would be drowned, that we would be killed. The other thing about Emmett Till's murder has to do with race and gender. It really highlighted the tensions between African-American men and white women. African-American men, one of the things that we're cautioned as African-American children is not only to watch out for the police as black men, but to walk around with our shirts off, because we might tempt a certain woman of a certain race. And that echoes all the way back to slavery. And yet with those tensions, we continue to go on as a country. And there's still a lot of hatred in the country toward African American and black people and people of color in general. And what can we do about that racism? Emmett Till was murdered and killed, and his mother made sure that the country knew how terrible this horrific event was, by having an open casket so everyone could see his face. His face that was not really a face, but it was a grotesque face that was dehumanized, like the bodies of many of us, particularly African Americans, have been brutalized over and over and over again. So the song I'd like to share with you, that Pastor Jim asked me to do a song, usually I sing a gospel song or a hymn. This is not my style, but this song is by a blues and jazz artist named Eric Bibb. I just learned it this morning, I think he wrote it this year. It's called The Ghost of Emmett Till. Battered face, a few years younger than Emmett Till, when he met his brutal fate. That photograph scared me so bad, I started to cry. What a way for a boy like me to have to die. Emmett Till is walking around the town of Money, Mississippi. Can't move on because hate is going on all over the country. That picture sowed a bitter seed in my frightened mind. From that day on, I understood some hated my kind. That photograph revealed a fact I could not deny. Like Emmett Till, a boy like me could surely die. Emmett Till is walking around the town of Money, Mississippi. Can't move on because it's been so long, 'cause the killers walked free. I remember that I started to shiver when I saw his face in his blood in the Tallahatchie River, left a permanent trace. What that photograph scared me so bad, I started to cry. What a way for a boy like Emmett Till to have to die. A boy like me to have to die. Oh, the voice of Emmett Till is walking around the town of Money, Mississippi. Can't move on because this hate is going on all over the country. The ghost of Emmett Till is walking around the town of Money, Mississippi. He can't move on because hate is going on all over the country. The ghost of Emmett Till is walking around the town of Money, Mississippi. His ghost can't move on because hate is going on all over this country. They can't move on because hate is going on over this country. So many hate is going on, and they can't move on because hate is going on all over this
So, beloved, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and in the word of hope, Jesus Christ. Go in peace. Amen.